Good morning, everybody. Good morning, everybody. It is good to be in the house of the Lord. That's not good enough. Good morning, everybody. It is good to be in the house of the Lord. We are here to praise our God. He is the Alpha and Omega. He is the beginning and the end. He is the Jehovah. And if that was for me, that would be good enough. But for God, we need to stand up and give him praise. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. We welcome everybody in, and those of you that are joining us online, we invite you to worship with us during this time and enjoy the service. Amen.
Jesus, be up and all around me every day.
I'm asking you to protect me.
Jesus, I want you to protect me as I travel along the way.
I know you can.
Yes, Lord.
I know you will.
Yes, Lord.
Fight my battles.
Yes, Lord. Jesus, be a fence.
Come on, y'all.
Amen. Amen. Don't you feel the power of a Holy Ghost just protecting us? Not only did he protect us through the night, he allowed us to rise this morning and come to this house of worship to give praise to our Almighty God. Thank you, choir. Thank you. Let us pray this morning. I will praise the Lord with my whole heart. I will tell of your marvelous works. I will be glad and rejoice in you. I will sing praises to your name, O Most High. Heavenly Father, once again, we humbly but boldly come to just say thank you. Dear God, we have so much to thank you for. When we begin to look back over our lives and see just where you have brought us from, we thank you. Through all the storms of life, through all the disappointments, but through all the joys, through all the uplifts, you never left our side. And you continue to bless and keep us. And we thank you this morning. We enter this temple and invite the Holy Spirit, dear God, to surround each and every person here this morning. Fill us with your joy. Fill us with your presence. Let us know that you are God and God alone. There is none like you, my Father. Lord, we thank you for keeping our families, for keeping our children, our neighbors. We thank you for this church family, dear God. We thank you for the shepherd of this house. And we thank you for Reverend Cogman, who is going to break the bread of life for us this morning, dear God. And Lord, we ask that you give him a special overflow. And dear God, that we receive the word, dear God, and just not receive it, but eat it, Lord, and go out into the world and share with others the goodness of the Lord and how he waits with open arms for each and every one. Just repent of your sins. Turn away, dear God. Put your hand in God's hand. That's all he asks. He died on Calvary's hill for us, dear Lord. He took all of our sins and then he rose again, dear God. He's alive, and Lord, we thank you for your sacrifice. Thank you for your love, a love like no other. Dear God, we praise you this morning and ask that you keep us from the back door, Lord, up into this sanctuary. Bless every heart. Bless every head that is bowed in supplication to you. We love you, Lord. This is your servant's prayer. In Jesus Christ's name I pray. Amen. Amen. Our choir will now take us back to the throne of grace.
How many of us have been through the valley? And when I say the valley is down low, right? And the point is to get to the mountain up. How many of us have been in the valley? No matter what that looks like, if you've been in the valley, Psalms 23 says he brings you through the pastures of righteousness. Hallelujah. The Lord is my shepherd.
The Lord is my shepherd.
He goes before me.
He goes
not behind y'all, but before me to stand in the way. Defender is behind me.
Defender behind me.
I won't fear.
I won't fear.
I'm filled with anointing, God.
I'm filled with anointing.
Yeah. Cups overflowing, yeah.
Cups overflowing.
Don't forget, y'all, no weapon can harm me.
No weapon can harm me.
I won't fear.
I won't fear.
So because of all of that, the people of God sing hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
I am not alone. Guides me.
He always guides me.
Yeah. Through mountains and valleys.
Mountains and valleys.
Oh, but your joy is refreshing.
His joy is refreshing.
And it restores my soul.
Restores.
Yeah. God brought you through because He's my comfort.
He's my comfort.
And you always hold me.
Always hold me
close. Thank you. And when we get quiet, there's a sense of peace to say, Hallelujah. Softly, because we're on the other side now.
Yes.
So there's a sense of peace. Yes. That He's my comfort.
He's my comfort.
And He always holds me close.
Always hold me close.
Hey, hey. Can we sing that one more time all over the church? Say hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
I am not alone. Come on and give God praise, y'all. Thank Him for not leaving you in the valley. Thank Him for walking before you and not behind you. Thank Him for making our enemies be in the back. And now we're peaceful because we're on the other side. Come on, God, give God praise. Give God praise. Hallelujah.
Good morning, Asbury Town, Nick. I'm Gerard Flemings. This is our brother Brandon Cherubi. We're here on behalf of the United Men's Ministry and Just Because to present our report card rewards. If you're not familiar with it, our report card rewards are where we, the men, put together money and we reward the kids for making honor roll. It's not only a reward, but hopefully we'll push them just a little bit more, do a little bit more, do a little bit better. And as we all know, education is key to their success in this world. So with that, I will let me explain a little more. So grades 3 through 5, they get $25 for honor roll and $50 for principal honors roll. If grades 6 through 12, they get $50 for honor roll and $100 for principal's honor roll. All right. So now the downside right now is I only have 4 in my hand, so I need you parents to step it up a little bit, please. And parents and guardians, push your kids a little more. All right. All right. So with that, I'll turn it over to Brother Brandon. I'm sorry. When your name is called, students, if you could come on up, get your reward, stop, have a picture taken, please, and then you can be seated. Thank you.
Good morning, people of Asbury Townick United Methodist Church. Today, I will announce the 4 participants that have gained honor roll through elementary school and middle and high school, which is also known as the usual suspects. Okay, I'll start with the first honor roll participant. Adrian Odin, 3rd grade, honor roll, $25. Myra Thompson, 5th grade, honor roll, $25. Myra Crowder Booker, 5th grade, honor roll, $25. Damari Watkins, ninth grade, honor roll, $50. Okay, that's everyone that has attended honor roll from the third, fifth, and ninth grade. The only good thing is that one of them actually showed up.
Thank you very much.
Okay, Carlina Brown will now lead us in the children's message.
Good morning, everyone. If you could bring your children up for the children's message, we have a special guest today. Come on up. Come on. You could have a seat. Come and have a seat. Good morning. Good morning. Hi. Good morning. Good morning. You want to come? Good morning. You want to sit?
You want to sit on by the speaker? All right. Good morning, everyone. Oh, come on. You guys can do better than that. Good morning. All right. Happy Sunday. So my name is Miss Carlina, and some of you guys in the church might know me and some of you don't. I usually sit right over there. But the most important thing is, does anybody know what I do or what I'm dressed as today? A scientist. I heard him shout it out. Good job. You're right. I am a scientist. But, you know, the most interesting thing about being a scientist is this. Do you guys know who the very, very first scientist was? No ideas? We celebrate him every day we wake up in the morning. Jesus, God is the very first scientist, right? God was the first scientist. And how do we know this? Because when there was darkness, he said, "Let there be light." Right? There were stars in the sky. We ended up with planets. The world was formed. He made us mountains and valleys. He put water on the earth. So yes, God was the first scientist. So I want you guys to do something for me real quick. Can you guys do this? I want you to put your hand right here in the middle of your chest and take a deep breath. You guys feel that? What's that? What do you feel?
Air.
You don't feel it? That's a good answer, air. What's that thing going like this? It's your heart, right? You feel your heartbeat, right? You feel God right there, the scientist. He's keeping you beating right now in your heart. That is the scientist God.
So we can almost say God is like a battery. He powers us, right? He powers us. He's powering us right now. That's our heart beating, right? That's God. But, you know, God, that's God on a small scale, right? God is kind of like an infinite power. He's like a big battery. So we should use, like, a better representation like this, right? He's our infinite battery. He's huge. He takes care of everything. So I'm going to put this down real quick because I'm going to show you guys something. Because with all things, with God, all things are possible. Matthew chapter 19, 26 says all things are possible. So this copper wire is going to represent God's connection. You got a question? Yeah, what's up? Oh, it came from my house. Don't worry about that part. The battery came from my house. But the point is, we want to talk about God's connection right here, this copper wire. So I'm going to show you guys something. Let me get my wire connected to God real quick. We got our connection right here. We are always, always plugged into God, right? So this nail is going to represent us being plugged into God because he's powering us right now, just like our heart's beating right now, right? He's powering us. And we are like magnets, because sometimes we're positive and we do good things, right? We go to school on time, we do our homework, all that stuff. But then sometimes God gave us free will, and we sin a little bit. We get a little wild, right? So that's all right. So, but we're going to have our plug. And then our last thing I want to talk about is our blessings or consequences, right? When we sin, we got consequences. But when we connected to God and we're doing the right thing, we have blessings. So let's go ahead and put it together. Let's see what happens. All right. All right, so everything's connected here, right? So I'm gonna have to put the mic down so you guys can hear me real good. So I'm gonna speak. When we are connected to God, we do our homework. Sometimes we go to school on time. We listen to our parents. All that stuff. When all those things come together, we get blessings. And it spins really fast. Look at our blessings. They're happening right there. All of our blessings. It's amazing when we have a connection to God. We have to have that connection to make these things work. Right? But what happens when we stop being connected to God? Well, things slow down a little bit. Maybe we aren't doing our homework. Maybe we aren't praying enough. Maybe our blessings slow down and we're not coming as fast as they used to. And you notice things stop. But we're always plugged into God. Remember that part. That's what the nail represents, us being plugged into God. So God, our verse for today is Jeremiah 29:11. For I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord. He has plans to prosper you, not to harm you, and to give you hope and a future. So why don't we maintain this connection to God? Because when we do that, like we saw before, and we stay connected with God, all kinds of blessings and things happen. So that's your message for today. And before you guys go to children's school, I want you to say something out loud. I want you to say, with God,
all things are possible.
God
has plans for me.
So when you go to Sunday school, it's okay to have fun with your friends. And it's okay to enjoy yourself. But remember, this is our time to have a connection with God and keep our blessings flowing. And that goes for all of God's children, small and big. Amen. You guys are good for children's church. Thank you, guys.
Everyone say, thank you, Miss Carlina. All right, so you're going to stand up nice and quietly, and you're going to meet Mr. Eric right there, and we're going to walk to Sunday school. Thank you, Miss Carlina.
Morning, church. First, I'd like to thank Carlina for that children's message. I know it's for children, but I think we got something out of it too, right? Yes. I also want to thank the men of our church in seeding into our young people to encourage them to do their best, the best they can do, and to our kids for continuing to do a job well done. I have a card here from the Anderson Fleming family, and it reads, "The kindness of others is a genuine reflection of the kindness of God." On behalf of the Anderson family, we want to thank Dr. Torrey and the members and friends of Asbury Town Neck for all the love, support, encouragement for the meals, desserts, flowers, lunches, visits, and for your continued prayers during our time of bereavement. Thank you for taking the time for being a part of my mom's homegoing celebration, especially those of you who pulled up your sleeves to be of service there. For all of you who made financial donations, thank you so much for your generosity. Our family has decided to forward all donations to the Lewy Body Dementia Association in memory of their mom, Ann C. Anderson, to further research efforts in finding the cause and developing the best treatments. And we, like so many others, are praying for a cure one day. Thank you again and love you all, Carla Flemings and the Anderson family. The Lord bless you because you have shown this kindness. 2 Samuel 2:5. Just a few more announcements this morning. We want to thank Reverend James Cogman. If you have not heard him speak, we are excited and want to thank him ahead of time for the word today in the absence of our pastor. We look forward to whatever God has placed on his heart this morning. So on behalf of Dr. Torrey and this church and their members, we welcome you once again, Reverend Cogman. We thank you for your willingness to step in. Today, we also want to honor our wonderful ushers. We say to them, congratulations on 128 years of faithful and consistent ministry of serving. For their faithful and consistent ministry of serving, loving, directing, and guiding members and visitors of our church. We love you and we thank you for your dedicated service to Asbury and beyond. To the high school and college students, the deadline to submit your application for the Dr. Ronald Ward Scholarship is next Sunday by the close of morning service. Please see the United Men in Ministry. You can submit your application to Mr. Gerard Flemings, Mr. Donald Lilly, or Mr. Carol Hicks, the president. We have been having some useful workshops here at our church. Last week, we had a mental health check-in workshop along with the Other 90% Biblical Approach workshop. Just gonna pause for a second. If you did not attend that workshop, the 90%, it was amazing. And so part two is next week. Next Thursday at May 11th at 7 p.m. We will continue with another financial workshop with James Henson and Henson Associations. Be sure to check your email to view promotional video and to click on the registration link to attend the online workshop.
Lastly, our weekly prayer and devotional calls are every Wednesday morning at 8 a.m. We invite you to join us. The conference number is located on the website and in your weekly email. For a church that prays together, stays together. We encourage you to continue to read the weekly emails to stay abreast of weekly happenings, deadlines, as well as other community events. This concludes the announcements for this morning.
Greetings, Asbury Town, that family and friends. Welcome to the ATN Network. Luke chapter 6, verse 38 reads, "Give, and it will be given to you, a good measure, pressed down, shaken together, and running over, will be poured into your lap. For with the measure you use it, it will be measured to you. Therefore know, God takes whatever we give and multiplies it so that we can be blessed to be a blessing." Brothers and sisters, currently we have four ways to give. You can call 410-647-3461 to arrange an in-person drop-off. You can mail your tithes and your offerings to 429 Asbury Drive, Severna Park, Maryland, 21146. Or you can visit our website, asburytownnet.org, and click the donate button. Or you can use the Cash App at $ATNUMC. Thank you for your continual support of the ministries of Asbury Townnet United Methodist Church. We invite you to continue to join us for worship and the Word.
Eternal God, we thank you for the gift. We thank you for the giver. We ask that you take this gift, plant it down in good soil, and that it return or harvest a hundredfold. Bless those who have to give, and bless those who give in time and talents and spirit. This we pray in Christ's name. And the people of God said, amen. Amen.
I like to just say this little simple, but I don't know what I need or what I want from God.
All I seem to do.
years ago. This is your chance for it to be your exodus. Let's leave it behind. If you woke up this morning feeling sick in your body, if you woke up this morning feeling tired, you're drained, all of the news is negative, somebody reach up and scream hallelujah, because today can be your exodus. Today can be your exodus. Today can be your exodus. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah.
I think some of you might have missed it. I think some of you might have missed it. And you know, I know I have a very scholarly background, but I had to go back and look up what is the definition of the word Exodus. And Exodus means a mass departure of people, especially immigrants. So what Donald is really getting at is that there are some things that are not of God that are foreign in our lives that we have to depart from. Depression, deliver me. This is my exodus. Anxiety, deliver me. This is my exodus. Financial hardships, deliver me. This is my exodus. The pain of my past, deliver me. This is my exodus. The pain of my present, deliver me. This is my exodus. That is a declaration of dedication to knowing that there is one that sits high and who looks low. And no matter what may be going on in my life, there's always the ability for me to get out. Get out! Get out! Woo! I don't know about you, but there have been some times in my life when I look back and realize if it wasn't for the Exodus power of the Exodus God, the delivering God, the prevenient grace of God at work in my life, I don't know where I would be. And I got good news for you. If you're still in need of deliverance, your exodus can happen for you right now. You don't need the choir. You don't need a word. What you need to do is just lift your hands right now and say, God, whatever it is that you can do for me. Do it right now. Call out whatever it is you need to be delivered from. And right now, all over the sanctuary, let's just worship God for a few seconds for the Exodus power that he's doing right now. Right now. Break every yoke right now, God. Loose every chain right now, God. Remove the toxicity right now, God. Heal right now, God. In the name of Jesus, we declare and decree wholeness in this space, forgiveness in this space, love in this space, peace in this space. It's time that you stop holding on to it, because God said, give it to me so you can be free.
My God.
Whew. The Spirit is already at work. And y'all do this to me every single time I come here. Every single time. But where the Spirit of the Lord is, the Bible says there is liberty. And whom the Son sets free can be free indeed. And we thank God for that freedom today and giving honor to that God, who is indeed the head of my life, to you all's pastor, but I just call her my friend, the Reverend Dr. Tori Butler, in her absence. I was talking to her last night, and she was enjoying her time away, and I told her, don't worry, I got your people. You just rest, relax, and recharge. Can we give it up for your pastor in her absence? We can do better than that. Can we give it up for your pastor in her absence? Amen. 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 I just have to say, as an aside, as you know, someone who has pastored, unfortunately, I've learned that not all pastors are actually great leaders. And not all pastors actually care for the hearts of their people. So I thank God that you all have a pastor who not only leads, but who leads by example, who not just cares, but cares with her heart, and who pours over and over and over again. The atmosphere has already been set, and God is here. And our scripture for the day is a very simple one, which comes from the book of 1 Chronicles, the 4th chapter, beginning at the 9th verse and ending at the 10th verse. And it reads as follows. Jabez was honored more than his brothers, and his mother named him Jabez, saying, because I bore him in pain. Jabez called on the Lord God of Israel, saying, oh, that you would bless me and enlarge my border. Some of your versions might say territory. And that your hand might be with me, and that you would keep me from hurt and harm. And God granted his request. Friends, for the time that is ours today, I promise you I won't be too long, but I want to talk to you from the topic and the theme, I'm diving deep. I'm diving deep. Will you all join with me in a brief moment of prayer? To the God of deliverance, continue to deliver in this place. To the God who gives us Exodus power, allow us to release what we need to be fully present in you right now. And I ask that you would decrease me completely, so that you and you alone, O God, may rise up completely within me. Hide me behind your cross, so that the entirety of our hearts and our minds may be transformed for your glory and your glory alone. It's this we pray in the name of your Son, Jesus, who is the Christ. And the people of God said amen and amen. So one of the things that's very important when you are a pastor is self-care. It's important for all of us, but I think it's especially important for pastors, because pastors spend most of their time pouring out into others. And it can become very dangerous when you're doing all the pouring and you're never getting any refill of your own. And one of the ways that we as pastors do self-care is we take vacation. And I hope all of you on your jobs take all of your vacation every single day, because I guarantee you this, once you leave, you're never going to get it back. Vacation is a very important thing that you use to rest and recharge. And I remember that when I was pastoring, one vacation I took in particular was to a bachelor party in Mexico. Yes, I know some of you gonna look at me funny, but I'm not gonna sit here and give you a front like I'm not still a person with friends and a life and everything else. And too many clergy suffer because they wanna sit here and put up a front for you. I'm not gonna do that. I went and I had fun with my friends. And something interesting happened while we were there. We were out on a boat party, and we stopped in the middle of this bright blue ocean in the Puerto Vallarta river area, right next to a roundabout in a bend where there was this nice rock that we could swim around. And the captain says to us, "You all can get off the boat and swim." Then he asks us the question, "Well, how many of you can actually swim?" We all raised our hands. But he said to us, "Even though you can swim, you still have to put on a life vest." Because a life vest, from what he said, saves us from the liability just in case something happens to you. And what I realized by this is that life vests are very important for our safety, but it doesn't help us to learn how to actually swim. A life vest can't teach you how to dive deep. The only thing it allows you to do is float and stay exactly where you are. You can get no higher, you can get no deeper. You will stay right at that very level, floating over and over and over again. And how many of us know that floating is an activity that makes us feel safe? Floating is an activity that makes us feel secure, but it also keeps us comfortable, curtailing our ability then to actually learn how to swim, or rather dive deep within ourselves or deep in our personal lives and even deeper into our relationships with our God. We don't want to dive deep. We don't want to get deeper in our prayer lives. We don't want to get deeper in our relationship with God, because some of us don't want to actually get real with our pain. We don't want to get real with the pain of past traumas. We don't want to get real with the pain of present circumstances. We don't want to process the mass shooting that just happened yesterday. We don't want to deal with the pain of racism, sexism, ageism, being forgotten, the financial hardships, the toxic friendships, the broken relationships. We don't want to deal with the pain. And some of us are having a hard time being in pain and staying in pain because we can't get past the pain of our unanswered prayers. So instead of us going deeper with a God who knows no depth, we put on a life vest when we go before God of comfort and safety, because we don't want to go to God in pain, because some of us might be scared that God doesn't have what it takes to actually ease our pain. We wear life vests every day. The life vest of the toxic friendship, the life vest of family drama, dare I even say the life vest of church hurt, the life vest of being misunderstood, the life vest of, as Fannie Lou Hamer said, just being sick and tired of being sick and tired of the pain that we feel inside, because some of us have learned through history, some of us have learned through personal circumstances, that maybe, just maybe, it's easier to find a way to live with the pain versus dealing with the pain. And it's in this state of mounting up and boiling over pain that we find our friend Jabez within this text. Now, the Bible just says that Jabez was honored more than his brothers. His name was because he was born in pain, and he calls on the Lord and asks for a blessing, enlargement, that the hand be with him and that no hurt harm comes to him. And we know it says that God grants him his request. But that's not very much information to actually know about who this Jabez person is. So as I did research, here's what I learned about Jabez. He existed in the days of the judges. So your judges, your Deborahs, your Samsons, your Gideons, those folks, he lived back in that day. He was one that, because of his rank, enjoyed a high status in the community. He was honored in the highest status of his family. Yet the one who was the most honored, yet the one with the highest status, is the one who literally has a name that he causes me pain or sorrow.
How many of us have done stuff in our lives over and over again, and no matter how much good it seems that we try to do for somebody else, the only name they can seem to call back to us is something that is mean, hurtful, or causes pain or sorrow in our very own midst. His mother called him pain because of the pain of his birth and named him pain because of the condition of her mind. But Jabez is saying right now that I want to counter what I'm being called by calling on God. How many of us can understand that the best way to be able to counter what's happening to us is calling on somebody who can do better than us? But the question I want to ask us as we move forward is that, are we like Jabez, honorable in our regular lives so that we can be fully present and honorable before God? Because honor is not something that is simply a singular action. It's a state of being. Are we living the life that reflects the prayers that we pray? I'm going to say that again. Are we living the life that reflects the prayers that we pray? Because if we have limited prayers, that means we have limited faith. And if we have limited faith, then we will have limited optimism. And if we have limited optimism, that means we are more prone to pessimism. And if we are more prone to pessimism, we, by extension, take away the power that God has to be able to work in our lives. Because sometimes that's the pain that we call self-inflicted. And how many of us can think about times where we have had self-inflicted pain? The pain of where God says, I shall supply all your needs according to my riches and glory, and yet you think that there is no way that it can happen. The pain of God saying that I have called you to bless you and to prosper you, and yet you doubt your ability to do the even most basic task of life. The pain of listening to somebody else's version of you versus the version of you that God gave you for himself. What I'm saying is that some of the pain that we feel sometimes can be self-inflicted. And Jabez is sick and tired of being sick and tired because he's sick and tired of feeling the pain that comes from what somebody else has named him and not who God has called him. So Jabez is saying that in spite of the status of the pain that he feels, he wants to do something that can heal his pain. And his prayer in our text is a cry of desperation to the one who can defiantly deliver from desperation. Jabez understands something important that you and I need to understand. Your prayer life doesn't just end with your communication with God. It extends to how you live your everyday life. Because if you know a God who can do exceedingly and abundantly, and your prayer life reflects a God who can do exceedingly and abundantly, it doesn't matter what life throws at you, you know that you can throw something back that they can't counter with. And what God is calling for some of us to do today is to take off our life vests. God is saying it's time for some of us to learn how to pray through the pain, pray through the doubt, pray through the emotional distress, pray through it so we can go deeper into the intimacy and intentionality of the relationship that God wants with each and every one of us. And the good news for us today, my brothers and sisters, is that the text gives us a few points as to if we're going to be able to move through our life vest and dive deeper with God, how we can do that. And the first thing that the text teaches us is that if we're going to dive deep and move and remove the life vest, the first thing we have to do is we have to know who God is. You have to know who God is. Well, what do you mean know who God is? I know who God is. It's the God grandmama used to talk about. It's the God that we had to pray to when we was kids, when we didn't feel like it, when we was 5 and 6. It's the God who maybe made a way somehow when I, you know, took the test and I didn't know what I was doing, yet I still got an A on it. We know versions of God. But see, Jabez and the Hebrews of that day had to learn an oral history of God. So they had to understand who God was from not just the experiences of the people, but through the power that comes in the different versions of God that their people has experienced. And what do you mean by that? I mean that they know God as Elohim, the God who is the God of creation. They know him as Jehovah, the God of redemption and salvation. They know God as El Shaddai, the God Almighty. They know him as Jehovah Jireh, the God who is the provider. They know him as Jehovah Nisi, the God who is the banner. They know him as Jehovah Shalom, the God who gives peace. They know God as a God of deliverance. They know God as a God of provision. They know God as a God of protection. They know God as a God of guidance. They know God as a God of peace. They know God as a God of blessing. They know God as a God of forgiveness. And they know a God that will never break his promises. They know that God that sits on the side of the oppressed. They know the God that specializes in things impossible. What am I trying to say? What I'm trying to say is, if you know who God is and you know what God can do, you won't shortchange your faith in knowing that your prayer has the ability to be answered. And maybe, just maybe, when you remind yourself who God is in the midst of your pain, you will have the prescription of helping to ease your pain. If you know the God who woke you up this morning, if you know the God who kept you through the weekend, if you know the God who kept you when you was messing up, if you know the God that blessed you when you didn't deserve it, when you know the God that covers your family, when you know the God that saved you from that bad marriage, when you know the God that saved you from that bad friendship, when you know the God who has done it for you over and over and over again, maybe, just maybe, in the present circumstances, the prescription is knowing who God is. Because when you know God and you remember God, it transforms you even before you get to your request from God. So the first thing the text teaches is that if you're going to take off that life vest and dive deep, you have to first know who God is. But the second thing you have to do, and this might be hard for some of you, you have to know that your expectation of your prayer ought to make you shout. The expectation of your prayer ought to make you shout. Notice what happens. He's sick and tired of being sick and tired. He summons the God who is the God who has, and the God who is, and the God who will, and the God who will be. And then he gets to his request. And what is his request? I ask for blessing. I ask for enlargement. I ask that your hand stay with me and that you keep me from hurt and harm. You see, here's what we have to understand about praying to God. Praying to God for blessing is not a selfish endeavor. Because, see, the purpose that God has for us in our lives is not just for us. The purpose that God has is like us putting our finger in a still thing of water. It ripples to every which way that it can go until it reaches land. When God does something for us, God expects the ripple effect of that blessing to be able to go and help somebody else. Because as Christians, we are called to build the kingdom on earth as it is in heaven. And the kingdom of self will never be able to sit in the kingdom of God. Jabez right now is asking for a prayer that is not just for himself, because he understands something that you and I need to understand, is that God's character is most aligned with those who are selfless versus self-centered in the blessings that they are asking for. I think that's why the songwriter just simply said, if I can help somebody as I pass along, if I can cheer somebody with a word or a song, if I can show somebody that they are traveling wrong, that my living would not be in vain. If I can do my duty as a Christian, or if I can spread the beauty to a world that's abroad, if I can spread that message of love that the master taught, my living may not be in vain. Jabez is asking for a blessing of favor and increased protection, not just for himself, but for his family. Not just for his family, but also for his community. Jabez is asking for his pain to end, so that way he can in turn be a blessing to those that are around him. God changed my perception, so I can be a part of the prescription for easing other people's pain. But see, here's the thing. He asked for it, but we don't even know God granted it yet. And the thing about it is, when you know who God is, The expectation of your prayer ought to make you shout and transform you in the midst of your pain. Because, see, the bar is much higher to be a Christian in the world. It's much higher. Trust me. I live it every day, you know, wrapping up year one of this MBA. The bar is much higher. People look at you a lot differently because there's a greater expectation because of the God that they believe that we serve. But the beautiful thing about it is being a Christian and following God means that we are being better people for ourselves, for our communities, and for our world. But also being a Christian means that we know God for ourselves and have expectation of God to work in our midst even when it seems impossible. So the expectation ought to be exuberant enough that the expectation of God's power being able to work ought to excite you enough that it can make you shout, because your expectation can bring deliverance of you in the midst of your situation before God gets back to you, to knowing that God is still in the blessing business. So therefore, there is always hope. So who has expectation today of God to do something in their midst? Do you have expectation of expansion? Do you have expectation of increase? Do you have expectation of chains coming loose? Do you have expectation of justice rolling? Do you have expectation of a new job? Do you have expectation of the family coming back together? Do you have expectation of love, of peace, of favor? And if you have that expectation, it ought to make you praise God in the midst of your pain for the miracle that has already taken place in you, the miracle that is taking place around you, because the expectation makes you shout because God is transforming you. Some of y'all gonna catch that on the way home. So if we're gonna take off the life vest and dive deep, we have to know who God is. We have to have an expectation that ought to make us shout. And lastly, and I'm on my way to my seat after this, we have to remember that God still answers prayers. I'm going to say that one more time for whoever needs to hear it. God still answers prayers. See, here's the thing, we get mixed up. We think that our pain is a byproduct of God being upset with us sometimes because we didn't do what God asked for us to do. He said, go left. I went all the way right. He said, go up. I went down as far as I possibly could. But see, we have to understand that a God who is eternal and supernal and whose very character and nature is that of love, grace, and inclusion is not the author of pain. Your anger has been misplaced for years because God's not the one that's causing your pain. See, here's what we have to understand. There is a world that has a very thin line drawn between it. One side is good. The other side is evil. We have to make the decision every day as to which side of the line we're going to exist on. But I can tell you this, evil is always going to be more enticing than good, because good comes with standards that evil does not. And so what happens is that there is a character named the devil who is the author of pain, who can use whenever you decide to step over the line into evil to make you feel a certain type of way, that every now and then when you're reminded of it, when you open your social media, when you open up your mail, when you go talk to your friends, your family, heck, even when you come to church, the devil will make sure that your pain is so consistent that there is nowhere you can go that you will be able to escape from it, because the devil is going to use your pain to push you away from your purpose. But I stopped by to tell somebody that God will use your pain, God will use your doubt, God will use your fear to prepare you for the purpose that God has for you. Let me tell you a quick story, and then I'm gonna sit down. So one of the things I got into when I was pastoring was golfing. I picked it up for the first time when I was 16, and I loved it because that's how I met President Obama back during the first administration out on the golf course. You know, he and I were about the same height, and everybody thought we looked alike when we were shaking hands. So they were like, oh, you must be his mini-me over here. But I put it down for a few years, and I picked it back up during the pandemic when I was in Flint. And for the life of me, how many golfers do I have in the room? How many golfers do I have in the room? Hey, see, you know, you and I stay on the same page with these things. So in golfing, the object is to hit the ball. And it's not just to hit the ball, it's to hit the ball in the right way with the right club to get it into the hole. But I'm sure all golfers can probably admit, and anyone who's ever been to Top Golf, one of the hardest things to do is actually hit a golf ball and hit it consistently. And so I had to prepare to go play with my cohort in what we call the McDonough Cup games. And in the McDonough Cup games, one of them was a golf outing. And I felt extra pressure because not only was I representing my cohort, I was the only black man on the entire course representing the school. So now I'm representing my cohort and I got pride representing my race too right now. So I said, for the life of me, I cannot go out there and embarrass myself. So I decided to go and do something I hadn't done before. I shut myself up in a room and practiced my swing. You see, in the gym, they have a golf simulator room where you can hit the balls into the net and work on stuff. And I realized one day that I'm like, something is just not right. I don't know what's going on. And then when I was in there, I just simply heard the Lord say to me, why don't you bend your knees a little bit deeper? And I kid you not, from the moment I deepened my knees and began to swing, I may not always hit it straight, but I've never missed the contact of it ever again. And what I'm saying to you sometime is that maybe, just maybe, if you bend your knees a little bit deeper and get before God, that maybe the answer might be there. Because here's the blessing of the text. The text does not give the time frame, but the text just lets us know that the request was granted. I prayed this prayer over 2 years ago, but God answered it 2 weeks ago. And what I'm trying to tell you is that Jabez prays for four things, and maybe not all of them were answered at the same time, but the good news is that God still answered his prayer. And that's good news for me, and that's good news for you, because that means that your unanswered prayer can still be answered. And if it's not answered, that means it's because God has something greater in store for you. Because when we know that we know that we know that God answers prayer, there's always hope. Now, how do I know that I know? Because even in the days of Jabez, the people were still in pain. They were in pain of racism. They were in pain of classism. They were in pain of economic disadvantages. They were in pain of spiritual bondage. And the people prayed and prayed and prayed for hundreds of years, thousands of years, through Exodus, through enslavement, through freedom, through rebuilding their own city. They prayed and they prayed. And God already knew this. God already had a plan for it. So God sent the answered prayer down through the seed of Abraham, through this line of Judah, born of a virgin named Mary. And that little answered prayer became a baby named Jesus. And the answered prayer did a lot of work of answering prayers in his life. Well, what do you mean? He answered the prayers of those who were blinded. He answered the prayers by making the lame to walk. He answered prayers by empowering the mute to speak. He answered the prayers by bringing that which was dead back to life. He answered all these prayers by breaking generational curses and norms around women, around children, around those who are disabled, because he wanted to make sure that everybody who was anybody knew that your answered prayer always has a seat at my table. And for this work of answering prayers, they beat him within an inch of his life. For this work of answering prayers, everyone who knew him deserted him in his time of need. And for the work of answering prayers, they marched him down the Via Della Rosa, put nails in his hand and nails in his feet. They hung him high. They stretched him wide. And for 3 hours, even in the midst of his pain, he was still answering the prayers of the pain of the people in front of them and the pain that was yet to come. And finally, when they thought that it was over, when they thought that they had run, they took him down off the cross. They put him down inside of a grave. But 3 days later, a prayer God answered. 3 days later, a stone was rolled away. 3 days later, God raised him from the dead and gave him all power in his hand. And so finally, when Jesus rose from the dead, we can say, because he lives, I can face tomorrow. Because he lives, all fear is gone. Because I know who holds the future. Life is worth the living. The prayer is worth the praying. The passion is worth pursuing, because he lives. And because of that, the answered prayer of Jesus is the ultimate answered prayer, that no prayer that you ever pray cannot be answered. What do you mean? There is no mountain that is too high. There is no valley that is too low. There is no crooked place that can be made straight. There is no rough place that can't be made smooth. There is no amount of glory in God in your life that cannot be dealt with. Why? Because better days have to come. The sun has to shine again. I think that's why his ancestor David said, I will remain confident in this, that I will see the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living. Because David knew what Jabez knew, what you and I need to know, that because of Jesus, because of God at work in our lives, there is no prayer that cannot be answered. There is no secret to what God can do. There is no limitation on your life. So get up, my friends, and thank God for the prayers that are being answered right now. Thank God for the prayers that were not answered in the past. Thank God for what he's doing right now, what he will do in the future. Why? Because of the cross, there is no limit to what God can do. So act like you know it. Praise like you know it. Pray like you know it. Hang in there. Take off your life vest. It's time to dive deeper and deeper and deeper. Get in your posture with God and understand that God's love will transform you the deeper you go into the depths.
I hear in my spirit right now that there's somebody that's asking God, well, how are you going to actually answer it? And God wants me to respond back to you by saying, by allowing you to let go of it. God wants to answer your prayer, but you and God can't operate in the same space. So God is saying, let go of it so you can let me take hold of it. And if there is one today who does not know this God of answered prayers, who does not know this God whose love is limitless, whose grace is boundless, if there is one who maybe if you no, but you're feeling disconnected from your prayer life, I invite you to lift your hand right where you are. And I want to pray with you, because one thing your pastor and I talk about so much is that the purpose of us coming here is to not leave the same way that we came. And if that is you, I just want to remind you, it don't matter who's looking around at you, because their prayer is not your prayer. Their pain is not your pain. And the purpose that God has for you is just for you. So every head bow and every eye close. Let us go before the throne of grace. Oh God, that you would bless us indeed. That you would enlarge our territory, that you would increase our space, that your hand would be upon us, that there would be no more hurt and harm that comes to us. We thank you right now for being the God of deliverance, exodus, answered prayers, and easing of pain. And God, whatever it is that is not of you, that's within us and within this space, we ask that you loose it right now in the name of Jesus. You loose any fear or trepidation, any doubt or anxiety that might come with your ability to answer prayer, not just here. We ask that the spaces that we're going to when we leave this place, that it be loose from them right now in the name of Jesus. That where we walk, that we where we stand, that it be holy ground, that our homes be consecrated, that our jobs be consecrated, that our schools be consecrated, that our relationships that we walk back into be consecrated for our healing and our wholeness. God, we know right now that there are some answered prayers out there. And God, if you can answer them, we ask that you answer them. But if you can't, we ask that you give the blessed assurance within each and every one of us to know that an unanswered prayer just means a greater blessing beyond the likes of what we can ask, think, or imagine. So be within us right now, oh God. Renew our spirits right now. Restore our minds and allow us to be able to go to you openly and vulnerably with any and everything that we need right now. Have your way in our prayer lives. Have your way in all of our personal lives. Have your way in our professional lives. Have your way in every space where we trod. Be with us and be in us, O God. This we pray in Christ's name. People of God said amen and amen. Can we give the Lord a hand clap of praise? Amen. Amen, amen, amen. We have now moved into our time of Holy Communion. And I want to remind you that in this, the United Methodist Church, the sacrament of Holy Communion is just another invitation into the open arms of God. So it doesn't matter who you are, where you're from, who you love, who loves you. It just matters that you just earnestly repent of your sins and know who God is, and you are invited to come to the table. Doesn't matter your denomination or your background. All we ask is that you come. And it is this Christ, our Lord, who invites us to his table. All of us who love him and earnestly repent of our sins and seek to live in peace with one another. And so therefore, let us, as people of God, confess our sins before God and before one another.
Merciful God, we confess that we have not loved you with our whole heart. We have failed to be an obedient church. We have not done your will. We have broken your law. We have rebelled against your love. We have not loved our neighbors, and we have not heard the cry of the needy. Forgive us, we pray. Free us from joyful obedience through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Hear the good news. Christ died for us while we were yet sinners, and that proves Christ's love for us. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven.
In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven. Glory to God. Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is right and a good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father Almighty God, creator of heaven and earth. Before the mountains were brought forth, or you had formed the earth from everlasting to everlasting, you alone are God. You created the light out of darkness and brought forth life on the earth. You formed us in your image and breathed into us the breath of life. When we turned away and our love failed, your love remained steadfast. You delivered us from captivity, made your covenant to be a sovereign God, and speak to us through your prophets. And so with the people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join in the unending hymn.
Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest.
Holy are you, and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ, in whom you have revealed yourself, our light and our salvation. In his baptism and in table fellowship, he took place with sinners. Your Spirit anointed him to preach good news to the poor, to proclaim the release to the captives and recovering of sight to the blind, to set at liberty those who are oppressed, and to announce that the time has come when you would save your people. By the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church, delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. The night in which he gave himself up to us, Jesus took the bread, broke it, blessed it, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do in remembrance of me." And when that wonderful fine meal was over, he took the cup, blessed it and poured it out to his disciples and said, take, drink. This is the blood of the new covenant. Pour it out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in remembrance of me. And so, in remembrance of these your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us as we proclaim the great mystery of faith.
Christ has died, Christ is risen, Christ will come again.
Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here and on these gifts of bread and wine. Make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, O God, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world until Christ comes in his final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit in your holy church, all glory and honor is yours, Almighty God, now and forever. Amen. And now may we all corporately join in the prayer in which Christ taught his disciples to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. The invitation has been extended and has not been expired. I'm going to ask now that you take your communion packets out and open the wonderful bread portion that we may partake together. These are nice. I wish we had these when I was at church. Have all served who wish to be served. Amen. The body of Christ is broken for you. Take, break, and eat. Amen. Do we all have our juice portions? Yeah, you're right about that one. The blood of Christ shed for you, pour it out for you and me and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Let us all drink together. And when the supper was over, they took a cup. And they sang a hymn going out into the Mount of Olives. And praise him, I'm going to ask you all to sing something for us as we go out. But before we go, I'm going to ask that we have all of our ushers come forward for a brief second because we want to honor you. We want to pray for you before we leave out. So can we give it up for our ushers one time? Amen. Amen. The Bible says, I'd rather be a doorkeeper in the house of our God than dwell with the wicked. And so we thank God for all of our doorkeepers now as they come. going to ask that we as the congregation, as the musicians keep playing, we need somebody to pray for us. Y'all keep playing that. Can you just extend your hands out to the ushers as we pray for them? Amen. Let's bow our heads for a brief moment of prayer. God, we are so eternally thankful for the work and the ministry of our ushers. We thank you for their faithfulness. We thank you for their service. We thank you for them being the doorkeepers as we enter into your gates with thanksgiving each and every week. We ask that you bless their ministry, that you enlarge their territory, that your hand continue to be upon them in this generation and the next. We ask that you would allow their ministry to continue to grow and to expand, and they reach a deeper level of spiritual growth and development and a deeper level of discipleship. Let them grow individually as the ministry grows collectively, and allow for all of us who are members and friends around be able to continue to bless and to support them over and over and over again. Bless them and keep them. This we pray in Christ's name. Amen. And ushers, as you go back to your positions, we're going to ask that you all remain standing for the benediction and for the sending forth. Receive now the benediction. To the God who is the God who calls us out of pain into purpose, to the God who blesses us over and over again, even when we don't feel like we deserve it, to the God who enlarges our territory to make us a blessing for somebody else, and to the God whose hand is always upon us, so that way there can never be a such thing as an unanswered prayer. We ask that as we go this place, as we leave this place with never from your sight, that the love of you, God the Father, the grace of your Son, Jesus Christ, and the sweet communion of the Holy Spirit be with us henceforth, now and forever, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen.
The times of prayer.
We fall down, but we get up. We fall down, but we get up. Oh, yes. For a saint is just a sinner who